The Willowman makes his regular call to encourage their captain, crew, and all.
Soon may the Willowman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
Well, welcome everyone. Let's go ahead and get started. Very happy to welcome you all to the Cape Cod Maritime Museum's Fall 2022 Lecture Series. We have a lot planned and are very happy that you're joining us today. Before I go any further, I want to make sure to acknowledge the wonderful folks at Mass Humanities. Mass Humanities is partly sponsoring today's lecture by their Bridge Street Initiative. They do wonderful things all across the state for cultural and historical organizations. So a big shout out to them for their support. We have so much going on at the museum this month. Coming up later this week, we have the opening of our new lighthouse exhibit, which is looking fantastic. And I hope you'll all come down and see us for that. And we have some great programming coming up as well. On Tuesday the 25th, we have Geotaku and Sake Night. So Geotaku is the art of the Japanese art of making prints from fish. So we're gonna do some of that and sample some sake as well. And if you're interested, you can sign up for that right from our website. So, but the museum, we are open. We're still open Wednesday through Saturday from 10 to 4. And if you're joining the lecture series and other programming at the museum, we hope that you'll consider becoming a member. Memberships start at just $50 for an individual. And it's a wonderful way to support the many programs that we offer, the development of new exhibits, all kinds of wonderful things we do at the museum. So hope you think about that. Today, we are very happy to have back again, Hartman Deetz. Hartman is an enrolled member of the Mashpee Wampanoag tribe. He has been a longtime advocate for Indigenous rights and the environmental movement. And as a cultural educator, he has worked with the Wampanoag Language Reclamation Project on the Wampanoag Tribal Museum and Plymouth Plantation. So he is here with us today to talk about restoring the Charles River watershed. And of course, marine scientists will often tell you there is really only one ocean in the world. All the water is shared all around the world. So certainly what happens up in the Charles River watershed impacts us all here as well. So we're very happy to have you with us, Hartman.
Hello, Mary. Thanks for having me again, and appreciate the time to talk. To folks out there, kui kwasan, natuswis Hartman, nutamas masipia, ka nin masipi wampanoag. Hello, my name is Hartman, and I'm from Mashpee, Mashpee Wampanoag tribe. That's, where we're the tribe that is on the very beginning of the Cape, down Cape. Near where you come over the bridges, that's coming into our territory. Pretty much have to cross through our territory to get any place else out in the Cape or the islands. I'm living in Boston these days and doing work up here, just a little bit north of our territory as it is now. But it's all, as Mary said, it's all connected. This water is all connected, but it's also, a matter of within the state of Massachusetts, looking at how we operate. And there's certainly a lot of access here in Boston to state level things. We've got the state house right down the street, and that's a useful thing to have. We want to see the state take more action in dealing with water standards and enforcing environmental regulation and, giving more serious consideration to plans for development and the impact that those things are going to have on water. And that's, these things are all really important. And to get those standards set at the state level, sometimes it's definitely different than jurisdiction by jurisdiction, each town. you know, in that regards, and seeing bureaucracy move and seeing institutions move, and you know, looking at the, you know, the Cape Cod Maritime Museum, it's certainly nice to see that you know, the Maritime Museum is, you know, looking at the water in a way that's beyond just the ships that traveled on it, but you know, the whole of everything that surrounds it, because of course it's all interconnected. You know, and you know, what would the ships navigate on if it wasn't for the waves under them, you know? That's, you know, that's just, you know, the truth of the matter. Yeah, and you know, this is a thing that we have to think about on Cape Cod. Being in Boston and being, you know, working with the Charles River Watershed, there's things that we do up here, but we also hope that a lot of these programs that we are able to see happen here might also be replicated, reproduced. You know, the issues of the Mashpee River are certainly near and dear to my heart as a Mashpee person. You know, my father's land abuts the Mashpee River itself, and we've had issues of, you know, toxic algae blooms and, you know, other things like that. So that's, you know, how do we deal with these things? And part of what we're doing here at the Charles River Watershed Association is they do volunteer monthly monitoring, and they do these ongoing programs between May and October of teaching folks how to do the BMI index, benthro macro invertebrates. So these are hard science skills that, you know, hard skills in science that we're going to open up opportunities for youth and tribal members to learn how to do hands-on experience. You know, going into the river, counting insect you know, samples in the riverbed, so we can see what the health of these tributary waters are. And we, you know, I hope to see not only, you know, native involvement from my tribe, but from throughout New England, so that these methods and these skill sets can be passed out throughout tribes that are, you know, everybody's impacted by water. Everybody depends on water. We all have to have it to live. It's one of the first things we look for when we look at another planet, as far as our ideas of colonizing space. We say, is there water there? Because without it, humanity can't stand a chance. You know, so to take care of that and to have these science skills, I think I'm hoping that folks will be able to replicate these programs in their own areas. You know, why is learning these things matter, I guess, you know, you might ask, but you know, they've got a volunteer monthly reporting of the health of these rivers and these tributary rivers that they do, and they put together a report card for the Charles River and actually you know, the three rivers that come into Boston, the Mystic and the Neponset as well. And we did an event just this last year commemorating the, you know, Clean Waters Act, the 50th anniversary of that, and the report card of all three rivers, and we get to look at, see how they're doing on a very, you know, easy communicable way, with letter grades like you would get on your report card as a kid, and folks can look and they can see that their creek, you know, down the road from their house is only getting a C or a D, and they might want to look at why that is. They might want to help to clean it up. They might want to take effort to maybe stop some of the damages that are being done, if those things are things that they could be aware of. And a lot of times that awareness is, you know, sort of bogged down in technicalities, you know, where you don't really get the clear picture of what's going on with, you know, where do we stand in things? You know, you get buried under these technical terms and words, and you know, it's not always as easy as just looking at, oh, well, you know, our stream back in the backyard, we got a C or a D rating. Let's do something about it. You know, so moving people to action is important. Having the skills to monitor the water is what creates those report cards. So, you know, to see something like that implemented on maybe the Cape wide rivers, you know, let's see, you know, Cape Cod emulate that practice and giving a report card to their bodies of water and their, and the different watersheds that are they're a part of the Cape, because we have a lot to deal with down there. We have to deal with salt water intrusion and more with places like the Otis Air Force Base or other places. We have to deal with contamination of the groundwater, more and more roads, more and more traffic, more and more runoff. All these things help to damage the water quality of that little sandbar, and so although there is a fair amount of water right now on Cape Cod, the conditions that keep it usable and keep it something that we can depend on is, it is something we have to safeguard, because it is at risk. As ocean levels rise, as we see more and more folks come across the bridge to settle into the Cape, these things are all things that we have to worry about now rather than worrying about them later. We're doing these things, and I'm trying to bring Native people into this organization's work and efforts. This is the Charles River Watershed Association. I've been hired on as a Native American consultant and cultural consultant, and I appreciate that there's organizations that are willing to look and do that. Because there are things and perspectives that Native people can bring to some of these organizations and these efforts. The water and the land have always been really important to Native people, the health of the environment around us, not only just for us as human beings to live, but to look at all the things that depend on that, whether it's turkey or whether it's deer or whether it's fish or quahogs or trees or whatever. These things are all a part of life, that we understand it, and all life's sacred. So if we think of all life as sacred and all things as being equal, truly, you sort of treat the things around you different. You treat a tree different if you're not above it. You treat a deer different if you're not above it. And these types of outlooks, I think, are really important to the environmental movement and to so many other things. I mean, of course, I may be biased because this is the culture and the community I grew up in, the values I grew up with, but I think they're important and they haven't been voiced enough. So the hard sciences is a great part of real skills that can be put to work to leverage real change in regards to taking care of water is really important. But there's other things that are involved, and I think that most efforts for action and organizing and to seek change or to try to move society in some kind of way, it's not enough just to come with data and somebody who knows. As I said, sometimes this stuff gets lost in the complexity of it all, when we even have the science reporting and all that. But not everybody is going to understand that the difference of 0.4 parts per million versus 0.004 parts per million, and which one's bigger and which one's smaller. That's that's confusing to some folks, but the ABCD is easy. But it's about capturing people's imaginations, and it's about maybe stopping to even get them to think in the first place. What is the health of the riverbed? What is this? Do I have an impact where I live? I'm in my neighborhood, and I don't know where a creek is nearby or a piece of water, but yet every street has a gutter and every gutter has a drain, and the things we do everywhere all eventually end up going into the water flows downhill. It goes down into the ground and it soaks in and it ends up in our aquifers. That's the truth of everybody's actions. It's just a matter of which way the water runs downhill from where you are, and there isn't a place where that doesn't happen. To help capture the imagination of folks is important. Just get them to maybe stop and think and consider. So there to engage folks in a way that might get folks to stop and question and ask, is also a part of what I'm hoping to see brought to the table in my position with Charles River Watershed Association. The Nipmuc tribe up here. Every coming up here in the end of October, I was trying to find the exact date, but I think if you search around, you might be able to find it. But every October, at the end of October here, they do a commemorative paddle, and this commemorative paddle is to remember the Nipmuc people and other native people that were interned on Deer Island during the King Philip's War. So during King Philip's War, it was, a war that was, in a large part, a war between religious elements. So a lot of the native people that had converted to Christianity were somewhat caught in between, as we saw that many folks regarded them as Christian, and yet had to wrestle with the fact that their Christian neighbors were still, different from them in many ways, as being native people. And there'd be difference in the way that they spoke and how they dressed and the food that they ate, even if they all, came to the church on Sundays. These things, there are still differences between them. And they didn't feel like they could trust them, even though they were Christian, and even though a lot of the conflicts, propaganda was very, very religious in nature. They decided they couldn't trust their neighbors, and they interned them on Deer Island. A lot of them died, starved to death, froze to death, because this is a small island out in Boston Harbor, and not very accessible to just be able to have the things you need in life to live, shelter. Food would be scarce out there because there isn't much, you aren't going to see deer living out there. You might see a bird land now and then, and I'm sure you could get some food out of the water, but how long is that going to last for a village, for a community of people? It didn't. Anyway, they commemorate this internment by canoeing, starting in Deer Island, and they canoe back up the river, back up through the Charles River to the Natick church, and then they commemorate their ancestors and the struggles they went through there. But to see this happen on the Charles River, I think, is a prime opportunity for an organization like the Charles River Watershed Association to help use some of that attention to find that crossover between where native values align with those environmental values of this organization that Native people have always valued and respected the river, and used the river as a highway, and ate from those waters. And throughout the Back Bay, used to be one of the biggest fish weirs known. Acres upon acres of fencing built to capture and harness fish so that they'd be there for easy fishing and access if you were hungry. Incredible networks of fencing were just built into the shallow water. And that's something to consider as well, that we manage to use these things and to interact with some of these environments, in ways that are different from how we often interact with environments today. Not that we didn't have a footprint, not that we didn't see change, but we sought to see, even in capturing these fish in certain areas, we sought to see that they would be able to survive, that they'd be able to have their health as well, because without that continual help of the fish, we aren't going to be able to have fish to continue to eat. Anyway, I get lost sometimes. I'm sorry. But to have that, have that canoe trip go up the Charles River as well. We can start to talk about some of these values and how we interact with the river itself, how these native values have been in place on this river and implemented on this river for, millennia and more, that we can bend back towards that. We can bend back towards taking care of it for future generations and not seeing how much we can extract from it today. And that's, you know, that's an important change that needs to happen, and people need to start to imagine things different. So to get people to pause and stop and think about this river that runs right through, you know, the heart of Cambridge and Boston, you know, it's, you know, it can be a really stark difference. And yet, you know, you get on a canoe and you get going up the river, you start to see the surroundings change as you get further up the river and you get into more of the rural areas. There's some absolutely beautiful sections of the Charles River, absolutely beautiful, you know, where I think I was on a canoe for almost an hour at one point without seeing much sign of development with my own eyes, even though I know it wasn't very far away. You know, you're still enveloped by the trees and the river, you know, the birds. It can be a really beautiful experience to have. Yeah, I'm right there for so many folks if they wanted it. I know I always find a lot of peace on the water. And I think if people engage with water like that, if they know that they can go down there and they can find their peace, if they can get their sense of their balance back and restored by being in that calm in spite of all the chaos, you know, I think that also helps to build appreciation. You know, building appreciation for what you have and what it has to offer is another, you know, key part of being able to move towards restoration and advocacy when you know the value of what that is. So just like that report card, you know, shows you, oh, we've got a D rating, you know, let's do something about it. We don't want to have a D rating. We want to have a B rating, like the folks up the street over there. How come they got a B rating and we got a D? You know, you can, you know, that's part of human nature. Everybody wants to be able to do good in comparison to their neighbors. You know, you want to be able to keep up. That's part of human nature. But also that human nature is part of like, oh, I enjoy this. I want to take care of it. And that can be another way to move people to take action, you know. Legislation is important. It's important to see some legislation happen to help protect these rivers. The Clean Water Act, when it was passed, had a huge impact on the Charles River, but not only the Charles River, it had a huge impact you know, on water throughout the country, throughout the United States. You know, this is, you know, fundamentally important as to why we continue to have clean water to drink today. At the point when that act was passed, I mean, you know, the Charles River had areas that were fenced off and that you were not supposed to go wading into because it was that polluted with, you know, whatever, car batteries and shopping carts and, you know, trash and rotting stuff, this, that, and the other. You know, it didn't matter. Everything got dumped into the river because it was just treated like a place that could take the unwanted stuff away. And, you know, that's that can only continue for so long. You know, we are here in a finite system in this planet Earth, and we act sometimes as if you know, we can always expand more and more, or that the, you know, we can always take more and more, or there's always, you know, there's always a boundary that's unreached yet and doesn't ever seem to be any closer to being reached. And yet we have plenty of boundaries and we have plenty of places where we've managed to cross over them. You know, I was absolutely dismayed to hear the science reports that, you know, rainwater is now toxic. You know, you can't just drink rainwater anymore. It's become, you know, become contaminated, what falls from the sky. And, you know, if that's not an indication of the ability of humanity to have huge impacts on this planet, I don't know what is. But if we can make huge impacts to damage things, we also have to remember that collectively we can also make huge impacts to change things for the better. That's also the hidden message in that reality, is that, you know, human beings are extremely capable of making world changes. What do we want those changes to be? How do we direct them? Do we want to continue to make changes that damage the world we live in, or do we want to make changes that start to restore balance and start to create sustainability? And I certainly would opt more for the sustainability of things. At this point, the Charles River is, vastly different river from what we have seen in years past. It's not, there's many places you can go swimming. And even in some of the places that were the worst back when, it's not a bad place to even come canoeing up from out in the bay, even down as you have the big buildings and you're in the heart of the city with the skyscrapers on either side of the river. It's still nice to be on the water. And I don't think that was always so. That's because of the efforts of the people around here and the Charles River Watershed Association and the EPA's Clean Water Act that got passed back in the 50 years ago, that's, these things all add up. So it can be changed, it can be redressed, but the best way to deal with this is not to actually have to go and clean it up or restore the order. They say a stitch in time saves nine, and that's the truth with the environment as well. The best way that we can move on things is to find ways to stop it from going out of balance to begin with, to make those shifts so that we so that we don't have to put all the work into restoring balance, but that we just do the little maintenance to make sure that things continue to run smooth. In that regard, one of the other things that we have, is, in restoration, there's, things like, looking at, the drainage from some of these large properties, and that's something that we are supportive of changes and policy that make it so that that big property owners are responsible for what comes off of their big parking lots and drains into the watershed and drains into the water. If that can be dealt with, that'll have a big impact on things continuing to move forward. It's nice to get a B when you're comparing to your neighbors, but of course, what we all should want to strive for is the ability to come back with an A rating, right? The best it can be. And restoration, even though we've come a long way, we've got more that we could see happen. There's the toxic algae blooms that have come up. That's an important thing, and we can see also some changes with that as far as nitrogen and fertilizer they're being used on lawns and golf courses, and it really adds up, the whole thing gets thrown out of balance, and yet it's nice to have a green lawn. Sure, I'm not against the idea that it's nice to have that and enjoy it, but we can all enjoy some of that in the season when it comes, and maybe appreciate that season because it has that to offer. Do we need to ruin our water to have it? Do we need to add extra nitrogen and see that run off and run into the rivers so that eventually, we can't swim in our ponds. We can't, we can't enjoy these things that are also so much a part of what make this part of the world special. To be able to go swimming in these little kettle hole ponds and such is great. Oh, that's to me quintessential part of what makes New England great is to be able to go through the woods and go swimming in a pond, out in the woods. That's great. And yet, if we continue to insist on, having more and more houses with more and more lawns and all of these more and more houses and more lawns and more golf courses and all of them have their fertilizer, it's choking it out. That's how come Mashpee Pond had to be closed to swimming in July this past year and the year before that in July. Like in the heat of the summer when you want to be swimming the most. And yet this is what we have to deal with, is that these things get closed off and closed down to us. And of course that drains into the Mashpee River and then on into the bays and into the estuaries. And you see the red tide starts to come earlier and you can't eat the shellfish. You can't go to the beach. It's, how much does that play out? And yeah, I like to be able to walk on soft grass and have it feel it under my feet. That's a nice thing, but is it worth the trade-off? I like being able to go to the beach too in the peak of summer. I like being able to go swimming in the pond in the peak of summer, cool off. It's not worth the trade-off to me. And I think for a lot of folks, if they stop and they think about it and they realize, they would realize it's not worth the trade-off for them either. And we can work on that kind of restorative stuff, dealing with the inputs. We also can deal with getting rid of some of the invasive species. That's something that helps to restore the balance of the ecosystem in the river as well, the different plants and even to some extent where you can the fish and the aquatic life too. But we've been have programs to remove invasive species such as the Japanese knotweed and the bittersweet and the water chestnuts, Japanese water chestnuts. And these plants, these every plant that grows has an impact on the soil chemistry, the water chemistry of what it grows in around and near, because these are they have a chemistry that's their own and a part of their own internal process, and that of course impacts its environment. So these things can make changes to the invasive species. You start to see some of the balance restored into the natural order of the river, and you might see some return of some of the species that are important to the balance of the river that you're actually living on. The cattail reed is something that's valuable for us as Wampanoag people. To have that reed is something that we use in our traditional weaving and to make to roof mats for our traditional style homes. And yet it's always being choked out by the Phragmites, and you see that around everywhere else. All these bodies of water where the Phragmites is just completely pushed out every last bit of the cattail reeds because they compete for the same environment. And the Phragmites you can't weave with. You can't weave with that stuff. It's not the same. And that's a part of our culture, a part of our heritage that we should be able to continue to have. We shouldn't be, forced out of that because of the lack of taking care of the cattail reed. But just like there's a part of us as Wampanoag people that depend on the cattail reed, so is there parts of this ecosystem that depend on that cattail reed. And if you deny it, you deny the living things that also use that as a part of their own means of survival and nutrition and the ability to call an environment home, their ecosystem. And so that shifts for them too. So you start to make changes in the traditional environment. You'll see that the animals that depend on those things come back too. They tell them folks to look out for the bees and look out for the pollinators and look out for the butterflies and to grow milkweed for the butterflies and to grow the early blooming flowers for the pollinators and to think about maybe, not raking your lawn so quick after winter to give some of the other, life underneath those leaves that have that shelter a chance to get to its next stages. And this is, something that just has those ripple effects. So we've got to do these things, but we've got to figure out how to prioritize too. What do we do first? Where do we start? We got to weigh the effort versus the impact and the timelines as well. And these things all have to be, figured out and discussed. This is the basics of what I've been doing is trying to find these cultural projects. The other one. Anyway, these things also could help spur people to action. These things that help show people where their standing is, or to show people how to value it as a river. One of the other projects that I guess we're going to start up soon is oral history project. So we'll hear from some of these folks that I've only been living in Boston for the past 4 years myself, but I get to talk to my father, and he remembers Boston when he was a kid in the 60s, and some of the times when Boston was, the Charles River was really at its worst. To hear him talk about how he remembers it versus how I know it to be. I told him I was picking up the canoe when I was down there. So I don't have space for it here. I've got an apartment, storage for a canoe. So I keep it on the Cape in Mashpee. And I was picking up the canoe, and I was telling him I was going to go canoeing on the Charles River. He was like, on the Charles River? Where? He's like, what do you mean you're going to go canoeing on the Charles River? It just didn't seem like, the thing to do for him. It seemed like why go to that river of all places? But I got to show him the pictures when he came back. He's like, oh wow, yeah, that is, where is that? Which part is that? Oh yeah, I guess so. That is nice, But to be able to talk to some of these folks who actually have that lived experience is something that really helps bring some of these things into reality. So we've got an oral history project. We're going to talk to residents and people around in the areas where this river runs to talk about their thoughts and their memories of the river itself, and even just to see some of these changes in this periods of a lifetime. I think it's important, and to look at where we've been and where we have where we've come to get here, and to think about where we're going too. It's an important reflection. Do we want to continue to, see an improvement on the river, or do we want to go back to, the robber baron times when everything bows to industry and everything bows to, the power of, money and who can profit rather than the health of the river? So to get these oral histories down of some of these folks, just, a lot of times, regular people, that have seen things that have impacted the river or their memories of the river, they can be relatable in ways that, and not everybody is, just to, find the folks that feel like your neighbor, feel like your uncle, even if you never met or seen the person, there's a real value in that. So those oral history projects, I think, is in one of the other projects that we're going to start to take on. And that's something where I hope that we can find, you know, some Native people to be a voice in that. I certainly got Native people up here I can think of that you know, like my uncle that remember, and he's been living up here for, yeah, I mean, all of my life, certainly. So to see what he's seen in his life and put that down, make sure that some of these Native voices get included. A lot of the times when he goes down to the river, he's got these paintings and work that he does where he gets really inspired by the river, and he draws in some of our traditional stories of Mashop and our our mythological characters of the creation of Wampanoag people and the shaping of the land here and how that happened. To see that reflected in the oral history project, I think will be great, because so much of history that we see starts with colonization, starts with, you know, the arrival of the European. And yet America has a history that's 12, 15, 20,000 years old, just like everybody in the world. You know, we as people have a story of how we've come to be here, and a story of our, you know, our creation and our past and our relations with our neighbors. So to even just include as a Wampanoag person to see some of our stories included in this is as an oral history project means that history is more complete. And you know, that's certainly something I always want to see as an advocate for Native people, is that we get included in the story, because we have always been here. We're still here, and I certainly would imagine that we always will be here. I certainly hope so. So these are the things we're doing, and like I was saying in the beginning, you know, that we've got these opportunities to see some training for kids and some of these hard sciences and hard skills in science. To see them be able to take some of these hard skills and maybe bring them back to their community, whether it's Nipmuc folks going out towards Western Mass, or if we can bring in some of the kids from Connecticut or some of the Passamaquoddies or Penobscot, I'd certainly welcome the opportunity to spread the word and share in some of the programming with them. But, you know, as well with these, maybe we can see these report cards spread out throughout all these different rivers. Maybe we can see some of these oral history projects spread out as well. Maybe we can see, the Cape Cod, the region adapt a report card for their different bodies of water and the watersheds that impact them. Wouldn't that be a helpful thing to have? You know, because we do see a lot of development, a lot of overdevelopment, continued development. And it's not just the bridges that can't take it. You know, it's the Cape itself. At some point we have to say enough is enough. And at some point, you know, we've got to look at, how much space do we really have to have the Cape be any different from Boston, and while I'm living up here and I'm enjoying the work and I'm enjoying many of the things that the city has to offer, whether it's music or, to be able to go to a Asian supermarket and get, ingredients I just can't find down the Cape on the shelf in the market here. The fact that I can, get, decent takeout delivery at midnight, things like that, these are some of the joys of the city. And yet, I don't want to see the Cape turn into that. I don't want to see the big buildings and the cement from one bottom corner of a building across the road to the next bottom corner of a building and back up again. I think folks want to be able to have what they have there, and what makes the Cape special is the fact that it isn't so completely, not so completely yet overbuilt. And Yeah, how do we hold on to what's precious? How do we hold on to what's valuable? I certainly see, you know, the look at how this impacts the water is a good way to do that. So,
Hartman, I'm just going to jump in here because we have a question. Someone wants to know, are there programs in which Native youth can actively help improve the environment and water quality around the Charles River or here on the Cape?
Here on the Cape, I would imagine that they should be getting in touch with maybe Mashpee Wampanoag Tribe's Natural Resources Department. I think it used to be Chucky Green, but he retired, if I remember right. I know up here in the Charles River area in Boston, the testing that we are teaching kids to do, giving them the hard skills is important, hopefully to be able to bring back to other places, but that this data is collected and then helps the organization to advocate for changes in policy and protections of the river. The success that we had of pushing to see the regulation of the runoff from big property owners like malls and such, from their parking lots. A lot of that success has come from the being built on the backs of the data that we can point to. So having those data sets and having that data to work with is an important starting point.
Hartman, can you talk about how students and particularly Native students are recruited for the project?
So we'll do outreach through the tribal council. So we've got all the different tribal members that are enrolled can be contacted through the different tribal councils, and the Mashpee tribe and the Aquinna tribe, Nipmuc tribe, the Massachusetts tribes in general would be the beginning of the outreach with that. But then we'll also probably be doing outreach through different Native community organizations that are in the area, whether it be North American Indian Center of Boston or Native American Lifelines or the different organizations that are doing Native work. We're looking at May through October of next year to implement the programming. So at this point, we have not gotten into the recruiting yet. We are still building it out as far as getting our dates set and knowing exactly what we have to offer so that we can tell people, show up on May 15th at this location, and then at that point the recruiting will certainly be a whole lot easier to do. At the planning stages that we're in right now, it's a bit hard to do the recruiting yet, just because it's one of the the where and when is one of the pretty foundational things that people want to know. So
where the rubber meets the road.
Yeah.
What age students are you looking for?
We're looking at middle school and up.
Okay, nice. Yeah. Nice. All righty. I'm wondering, you mentioned a little bit earlier origin stories, and so many of them have to do with water, sometimes floods, often have to do with clay, a substance that contains a lot of water. And I'm wondering if there are Wampanoag stories about the origins that that incorporate those things.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Our creation story of the first people, the first girl is carved from the white pine tree, but she gets lonely and wants someone to keep her company. So creator creates the first boy from the foam of the sea. So that's part of the very, very creation of of all of us that we, you know, as we understand it. You know, and when we look at the stories of how the land was changed, it's so much of the stories are of our giant mashup, and you know, whether he's digging out, you know, so much of it has to do with where the water is and islands, and you know, I talk about some of these kettle hole ponds being where he stumbled and stuck his foot in, and or where he used his hands to dig out a hole for a fish. So he had, there's a woman he admired who would sing, and he admired her so much that he wanted to impress her, and she said she wanted to have a fish for a pet, and he goes out there to towards Brewster, and uses his hands to dig out a pond so that she will have a place to keep her pet fish to impress her, and that pond out there has the caves underneath it, the finger caves underneath it. So yeah, it's interesting to see how that story helps, you know, to connect all those things. They talk about the Elizabethan Islands being when he was out trying to make a weir, a fence in the water out of stones to get the fish to go fishing, and he had an apron full of rocks, and he gets bit by a crab, and he jumps, and all the rocks go flying out of his apron, and they make the Elizabethan Islands. Wow. Yeah, so these are, you know, these are some of the stories of the shaping of the land, and yeah, and whether they deal with the water itself or the interactions of the water, it's all certainly built in.
Yeah, and I really think as you hear stories from all over the world, all kinds of different parts of the world, again, you know, water is always in there somewhere. It's always one of the kind of foundational elements of the universe. And, you know, it is our common heritage. So I was also thinking, as you were talking about what the Charles River was like, you know, say back in the 60s. This is actually a story from probably the late 80s. I had a friend who was walking along the Charles River with her dog, a little white poodle-y thing. And she was looking over at something and all of a sudden heard this sort of plonk sound. And she realized that the dog had fallen over the side of the bank and into the river. And so she said she thought, oh, well, every animal, if you throw it into the water, will know how to swim. Said, no, in fact, this is not true. She said the dog sank like a stone. And the only thing she could do was to wade out there. And she said the water was so black, she couldn't see anything. And she just had to sort of shove her hands below the surface and grope around till she felt something roughly dog-like. So she did finally manage to haul him out, but the poor dog was just black and oily and rather foul-smelling, she pointed out. But it really is a testament to people acting on their own feelings of care for the environment that can take it, you know, from that point to this point, you know, 40 years, and to see really people can make a difference. These are not problems that are insurmountable, that when we group together and decide we really want to do something about this, change absolutely can happen.
So, yeah, absolutely it can. And, you know, yeah, that's, you know, we've got to take action. We've got to believe in ourselves enough to do it. And I think that's one of the first steps is believing that we can succeed. And it's important to know that we can. So,
yeah, absolutely. So in terms of kind of the nuts and bolts of the report cards for the watershed, I understand that there are different report cards for different stretches. Do you end up generating kind of one sort of massive kind of overriding report card for the Charles watershed as a whole.
Yeah, and then it all boils down to, yeah, you'll get at the end three letter grades, and the three letter grades will be for the Neponset, the Charles, and the Mystic, and that's, you know, that's how that will go. And then within the Charles, you know, each little tributary will have its own letter grade, and then those grades are averaged out to create the grade for the whole river.
Nice. How long has that grading process been going on?
I'm unsure when they started with that. That would be good to know. I know this is the first year that the Watershed Association has taken over the legwork of creating the report, as opposed to just supplying the data to the EPA, and then the EPA would create the report. But yeah, the EPA created the report for a long time. You know, so the grades have been issued for a long time. I don't know when they actually started doing that. It'd be good to find out.
Interesting. It's interesting that that's going from sort of federal control to local control. That's kind of a telling thing to have happen. But
yeah,
we've got another question here. Have you identified local scientific or environmental groups that can help with guidance? I think it means guidance for the students who will be.
I mean, Charles River Watershed Association is an environmental organization, and they have scientists on staff that have their college degrees in their respective sciences. So, that's one of the great things about teaming up with this organization, is that they have those kinds of resources to offer. And we have people within the tribe that have some of those things to offer as well, but what I often see within the tribe is that people who have those skills are oftentimes spread so thin to get their time and their focus and their attention from all the different angles that need it is oftentimes hard. So to have those extra resources and those assistance from the organizations like this that have, you know, people on staff to offer that are specialized in that is great. So I'm looking forward to see this partnership develop where we can take advantage of those skill sets and those services, because, you know, they are needed to help make those things happen.
And I kind of wanted to ask you about, do you think that there are, you know, two or three concrete things most people can do to help improve water quality? You know, are there particular things that we can actually be acting on in our daily lives?
If you're, I guess it all depends on what your situation is, but yeah, I mean, there certainly is something you can do as a person to help shift the environment and protect the water quality. One of the main things that we're trying to push, is the reduction of nitrogen fertilizer use, which not everybody has access to. Not everybody is a property owner. Or, you know, some properties don't even have yards, but if that is something that's around in your daily responsibilities, just to rethink that, think about what a change could look like, even a cutback, as far as how often might be an improvement, but every little bit. If you have a dog and you walk your dog to clean up after your dog, and that's actually a huge nitrogen addition to water as well. You know, as it's actually from dog waste there. You know, and that's, you know, that's something that we can be conscientious about. You know, thinking about what goes into your gutter as far as your car and taking care of that, you know, to make sure your car is running clean. And almost everybody has a car. If you can avoid a car and you can ride a bike, you know, or even if you can just do that sometimes, that's something that's helpful, because all that, you know, any kind of oil or whatever that builds up on the road is, when some point it's going to rain. And when it does, that rain's going to take it to the gutter, and that gutter's going to take it somewhere. And that's, you know, that's stuff that's forever. Recycling plastics, of course, is huge. You know, it's something that we have stopped doing with some of the stuff we even put into our bins, which is ridiculous and terrible. You know, that we would stop that. But I guess there's no economic incentive at this point. So, you know, once again, the matter of dollars and cents overrides the matter of common sense of making sure we've got a world to live on. But, you know, these are things that can help. And, you know, also just anybody, everybody, we all have to turn on the sink. We all have to turn on, you know, the washing machine. We all have to do these things. But to think about just those, the water use that you're doing every day, you know, how do we sort of shift to have a little bit more respect for the water that we're using and how much we're taking? You know, not letting the faucet run when you're brushing your teeth, and to just sort of think about water as something precious and not just to take it for granted. It is something that's always going to be there, because at this point, if we continue to treat it like it's always going to be there, you know, we've got maybe 20, 30 years until we really might have a problem. You know, the truth of the matter is that we are already seeing places in the world that are suffering conflict from water resources as far as availability. You look in East Africa, there are already conflicts that are starting to brew up into violence over water rights. And not too long ago in the Southwest here, we've seen, you know, the issue of water rights, you know, really, really come to the surface on the tensions of how folks are dealing with things. So, you know, not to take those things for granted and realize that water is precious. We all need it.
I thought it was interesting. Earlier on, you referred to certain parts of the natural world as our peers. And I think that's really an interesting mindset. You know, well, how am I going to treat the pond in my backyard if I look at that pond as my peer? You know, I don't have any more right to be here than the pond does. You know, what does it mean to, you know, walk through a lovely wooded path and see those trees as your peers?
Yeah.
I think that's really an interesting mindset to sort of try to carry with you for, you know, a day or two and see how that makes you think about how your own life might be impacting those other peers.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's a group, Movement Rights, that has, you know, been working. They have a number of places. They started, I think, in New Zealand, and I know just recently they had a campaign in Oklahoma to imbue certain bodies of water as, you know, with the rights of nature or with the right of personhood, legal personhood. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, that they've got the idea that, you know, Bank of America or Coca-Cola can be a legal person, you know, which I find to be, you know, quite a stretch of the concept of personhood. But if we accept that as law, which we do, if we accept that as, you know, not just a laughable thing, then certainly Certainly, we should be able to accept the idea that a river can be a person as well, that a mountain can be a person. If Coca-Cola can, and certainly, you know, the Mashpee River should be able to have that legal personhood to be able to continue to exist, to if it's damaged, to seek, you know, to seek damages, you know, if it's, you know, in some way impeded, to be able to you know, rectify the situation to continue. You know, this is something that we're seeing develop in other parts of the world and put into action as far as law. So to see that happen in this part of the world, I think would also be a great benefit to being able to advocate for, you know, the needs of the river. You know, it makes it a person, it makes it, you know, on the legal level, you know, and with that, you know, what's good for the river, we have to consider its needs.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think we're going to have to leave it there for today, but I want to thank you again, Hartman, for joining us. And for all of our viewers, our next lecture will be 2 weeks from today on October 30th. That will be Sandy McFarlane, who's going to talk about 50 years of shell fishing in New England and how that whole industry began. So we hope to see you then, or we hope to see you at the museum. All right, take care, everyone, and we'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks for having me.